Thanksgiving to our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Anyone remember the Bible challenge? We did it several years ago now. Remember? Yeah? Okay. The Bible challenge, if you weren't here at that time, was we challenged ourselves to read through the whole Bible in 1 year. Guess how many of us made it? Long before that year was up, many of us had given up somewhere, maybe in Numbers or Leviticus. So, for those of you who gave up, or those of you who never signed up, I'm going to now give you a very quick, down and dirty synopsis of the Old Testament. It basically revolves around two things: Exodus and exile. That first thing is of the Exodus. That's the story of how God's main man, Moses, led the Hebrews out of slavery in Egypt into the freedom of the promised land. The psalm, our psalm for this week, refers to that. It's Psalm 66, and it starts out, "How awesome are your deeds." It's the Exodus that they're talking about. How awesome are your deeds of saving power, your liberation from oppression, your miraculous deliverance, your wonders, your power to break the power of bondage. It's mentioned, Exodus is mentioned over and over again in the Bible as a reminder of God's power to save. It serves as a metaphor for our baptism, even. So it comes, that theme comes right over into the New Testament and right over into our lives as Christians. So in the waters of baptism, we pass from slavery to sin into the freedom of eternal life with God. So the Exodus, God's salvation is at hand. And God cares about us personally and about the world at large. The second theme is exile. Exile. The exile, the geography of salvation, looks very different than it looks in Exodus. See, about 800 years after they were brought in freedom to the promised land, the people are conquered by the pagan Babylonians. And the best and the brightest, the cream of the crop, are hauled off as captives to Babylon. And the rest of the people, the hoi polloi, are left to fend for themselves after Jerusalem has been leveled and the land around Jerusalem has been ruined. So what happened? Where were God's mighty deeds of power? Israel was God's elect people, so how could he let this happen to them? The exile is a time of subjugation, of servitude, of banishment, of failure, isolation, loneliness. It was a time of deep despair. By the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and there we wept when we remembered Zion. If you're a reggae fan, you can't help but put that to music, right? By the rivers of Babylon, where we sat down, and there we wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there, we hung up our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. And our tormentors asked for mirth. They said, "Sing us one of those songs of Zion." How could we sing this Lord's song in a strange, foreign land? These people had been torn from everything that was dear and familiar to them and thrust suddenly and violently into a new situation that was everything they dreaded. Everything they dreaded. The god Marduk sat at the top of a 25-foot tower. Land of deep darkness. Pagan. And here they were, landed as captives. And you know what they learned? They learned that God is here too. God isn't just in the exodus, a celebration of the powerful times of life. God is in the exile times of life too, in the dark and despairing times of life. The geography of salvation is complex, and it includes the valleys as well as the hills. Salvation and healing are in the crooked places as well as in the straight and easy places. They learn that God is at work in the hard road of trouble, as well as in the warm, cozy places of home and comfort. They learned that Yahweh God is the God of all places and of all people, not just good places. But they don't know that yet. So how are they supposed to make it? How are they supposed to live so far from what's familiar and comfortable? Now Jeremiah was one of those, I guess he wasn't cream of the crop, I don't know, but he wasn't hauled off in Babylon. He was one of those left behind in the, you know, ruins of Jerusalem. And he writes to the people that have been hauled off into captivity. He sends them a letter that's meant to encourage them, you know, to give them a way forward. Now, you might think he'd send them an upbeat and optimistic letter. Has anybody ever been in a time of deep despair? And you have people come up to you and say, there's got to be a reason. You know, God has a plan. Don't worry. God's got you covered. I mean, you hear these kind of things, right? And they're not necessarily very helpful. What Jeremiah says is totally none of those cliches. So what he says is, this is what the Lord God Almighty, God of Israel, says to you. Says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and settle down. You'll be here for a while. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Don't keep longing for those old foods, those old ways, because they're not here anymore. So plant gardens now, where you are. We've got the saying, right? Bloom where you planted. Bloom where you planted. Plant a garden here, in this situation. Marry, have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too might have sons and daughters. In other words, there is no quick fix. There's no quick fix. You might be here for generations, and they were there for generations. Some of those originals died before they were allowed to go back and rebuild Jerusalem. This is going to be the long haul. So settle in. Even maybe intermarry. Get to know the people around you, your enemies, and make them your friends. This situation that you did not want, that you did not ask for, that is everything you don't want, settle in and make it your friend. And pray. Pray to the Lord for the city which I've carried you into exile. Pray for your enemies. Do good to those that persecute you. Remember, Jesus said this? Jeremiah said it a long time ago, before Jesus. Pray for the well-being of the city to which I've carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. So number one, you're in Babylon because I carried you there. You got to learn what I wanted you to learn back in Jerusalem, which you never learned. Prophet after prophet said, take care of the poor. But you didn't take care of the poor. You exploited the poor. You're reaping the consequences now. They need to start paying attention to God's rules. Follow God. That was number one. I was saying number two, there's no quick fix in sight. Your new reality, make a life here. And number three, don't isolate. Do not isolate in this new situation. Extend yourselves. Learn your enemy's language. Make lemonade from lemons. In other words, embrace this new reality. Don't resist it. Release what you no longer have. Release your dreams and hopes for what is not. so that you can receive what is. There is salvation here in this strange new land, as well as in the familiar places of your heart. Let go of your past. Accept your new circumstance, however unthinkable that might be to you, so that you can receive. Those are my words to you too for this week. Release, so that you can receive. Now, I don't know what you might need to release in your life. I've been living with this for a while, so believe me, at first I thought, I don't need to release anything. We'll live with it for a while, and you'll see that maybe you do. You might be carrying around some old grudge you're not even conscious you're carrying. That's okay. And it'll bubble to the surface. Release it. You might be carrying some older dream that is not happening. Release it. You might be carrying somebody, you know, something around you need to forgive. Release it. Maybe it's worry. Maybe it's disappointment. Maybe it's bitterness. I don't know what it is for you, but I'm guessing that each and every one of us has something, at least one thing, that we need to release. So that we can settle into what is, and we can receive the blessings of the place where we actually find ourselves, the reality in which we actually are living. Because God is here too, in this new reality. In a political landscape that none of us could imagine living in. In a world where, I don't know, evidence is mounting that climate change may be irreversible. There is so much about this new landscape that is foreign and unknown to us. But our welfare and the welfare of the world around us depends upon our settling in, accepting, releasing the past, and praying for what is. Later, Jeremiah sends them another letter, and it says this, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Hope and a future. Let us release our praise this morning, even if we don't feel like it. Let's release our praise so that we can be showered with blessings. Amen.